Khrushchev wrote in his memoirs, "Have you never wondered why the President of the United States was not present at the launch of Apollo 11? Eve Kendall, Nixon's personal secretary at that time, made it clear that she would not object to stirring up some 30-year-old memories. It was Henry Kissinger who first took her on as an intern in the White House when she was still only 20. In Washington, Donald Rumsfeld, newly appointed defense secretary by President George Bush, celebrates his arrival in the Pentagon. With him are the ex-secretary of state Henry Kissinger, Lawrence Eagleburger, General Alexander Haig, and the head of the CIA, Richard Helms. 30 years previously, these five were President Nixon's main advisors.
Are we through?
All right. One more drink and then I'm ready.
There you go.
I'm only teasing you.
You have a great chance to make a fool of me.
What is going on? What in the world? Hello, Mel. How are you?
I don't know. He looks a little slippery to me.
Now, how are we doing this? You're asking the question.
In French, answering English.
Well, but then you're going to have to translate it so I know for sure what I'm being asked. Mm.
I understand French. I don't speak it very well, but I understand it.
Okay.
What's your problem?
No. Don't worry about it. It's okay.
Yeah, but those are the kind of questions that you have on TV every night.
That's a long, complicated story.
Only a few people need to know.
I'll tell you a fascinating story.
The whole thing?
Are you running?
You're going to cut it all out of this thing anyway, but...
Let me tell you, off the record. Turn the camera off.
It's an incredible story. Newly elected, Nixon was up to his neck in the Vietnam War. He needed a big stunt to reverse his negative image with the American public.
President Nixon was on the telephone, speculating. He kept fiddling with the telephone cord. The Oval Office was in semi-darkness, and I found it very difficult to take notes of this meeting.
We had a meeting and talked, and he had made a number of decisions already. Basically to try to calm things down.
The director of the CIA was looking panicked. He always overestimated the power of the Soviets. The Russians will put a man on the moon. It's only a matter of months, maybe even days. I have very accurate information about that. We can't wait another year. We have to launch Apollo 11 as soon as we can.
I was on the telephone constantly and at meetings and various other ways, trying to promote more energy, more aggressiveness in this matter.
I said to the president then, I said, you can't let this succeed, and you must do everything necessary to make sure that it doesn't.
Now the president turned to his experts at NASA and said, are we ready? The director of the space agency only half reassured him. He said, we might not be able to send back films of the first steps on the moon. Well, President Nixon refused that idea. No way. The whole world is waiting to see an American take the first steps on the moon.
He was very upset about it, and that he felt that something had gone wrong and maybe he was responsible.
The President of the United States was irate.
The sequence of events I remember as the most tense.
Then one of the presidential advisors, I don't know, General Alexander Haig or Donald Rumsfeld, said hesitantly, what if we film the first steps on the moon in a studio? Then if we fail, we can always show those pictures to the public.
I talked to the president and Kissinger supported it.
And at first I didn't take it very seriously, and I was told not to take it very seriously. Then it kept going on and on and on.
The president was prepared to do so, and I was prepared to support that.
And that was decided basically by Henry, Al Haig, and the Secretary of Defense.
But in the last analysis, the only person that could make the decision to do A, B, or C is the President of the United States under our system, and he would have to order it done.
Nixon settled back in his chair and closed his eyes for a few minutes. And then he stood up and said, gentlemen, you have less than 2 weeks to get everything prepared.
that was big. That was a big idea. It was an important thing, and a lot of effort went into it.
It was an anguishing decision for President Nixon to make. And I think he made the right decision.
He was the president, and he deserves the credit for having had the courage to do it.
He did that on his own. Sensible thing to do.
Then he came over to me and picked up all my notes, ripped them up into little pieces, and threw them in the wastebasket.
No stage in my life could I ever have anticipated that this would happen. And no stage, not even when I was made National Security Advisor. And I think it is a great symptom of the strength of America that this was even conceivable.
I thought it was the right thing to do because we have to do something to show that we're still the United States of America. We walked out of the room, and President Nixon said, I've decided to do that, and I need you to do this job. We're going to do it. It was just amazing. So we were trying to figure out who would do what when. He simply has got to have the person he wants in that job. And it has to be someone who's capable of doing it. And it has to be somebody he knows well. I said, I'd like to talk to one person. And he said, who?
Donald Rumsfeld was the first to propose Stanley Kubrick. The film would have to be perfect, but the set could never be built in time. The filming of 2001, A Space Odyssey, was drawing to a close in a suburb of London. Why not use the sets there? Rumsfeld was sure that Kubrick would not refuse. During the Kennedy administration, the White House had granted him special authorization to access strategic areas of the Pentagon during the preparations for the film Dr. Strangelove. Kubrick owed them. I told Mr. Nixon, it's very dangerous to lie in the United States. You can't pull a con like that in a democracy. Too many people would talk. It would be absurd. But he said, almost sadly, go ahead anyway. Rumsfeld offered to go and negotiate personally with Stanley Kubrick. He and Henry Kissinger flew to England that same evening. Kubrick was surprised and amused by the idea, but began by refusing. Rumsfeld wouldn't give up. We're only asking you to do one thing. Just leave us the keys to the studio for one weekend, just so we can shoot a bit of film and take a few shots. Everything will be tidied up again by Monday morning. Kissinger flattered him, telling him that Dr. Strangelove was one of Nixon's favorite films. In the end, Kubrick agreed. The fake footage would be shot in England in the MGM studios near Boreham Wood with a skeleton crew. The two technicians and two actors would be CIA agents. To guarantee their trustworthiness, all had to be single men without family ties. They would sign a contract committing themselves to perpetual silence about the whole affair. Once the filming was over, they would have to disappear. But Stanley Kubrick was a perfectionist. Faced with the CIA crew's lack of professionalism, he ended up, against his better judgment, supervising the shooting of the fake moonwalk. But, he told them, from Monday morning, you're out of my life for good.
My goodness, that is somebody.
At this time, I'd like to introduce the Apollo 11 crew, astronauts Neil Armstrong, Michael Collins, Edwin Aldrin. Neil?
It was our pleasure to have participated in one great adventure. It's an adventure that took place not just in the month of July, but rather one that took place in the last decade. We all here and the people listening in today had the opportunity to share that adventure over its developing and unfolding in the past months and years. It's our privilege today to share with you some of the details of that final month of July that was certainly the highlight for the three of us of that decade. We're going to divert a little bit from the format of past press conferences and talk about the things that interested us most, in particular the things that occurred on and about the moon. We will use a number of films and slides which most of you have already seen, and with the intent of pointing out some of the things that we observed on the spot, which may not be obvious to those of you who are looking at them here from the surface of Earth. The flight, as you know, started promptly. And I think that was characteristic of all the events of the flight. The Saturn gave us one magnificent ride. Both into Earth orbit and on a trajectory to the moon. Our memory of that actually differs little from the reports that you have all heard from those previous Saturn V flights. And those the previous flights served us well in preparation for this flight in the boost as well as the subsequent phases. We would like to skip directly to the translunar coast phase and remind ourselves of the chain of events, that long chain of events that actually permitted a landing, starting with the undockings, or the transposition and docking sequence.
I'm talking with Bill Kasing, and Bill Kasing is what you might call a pioneer in this whole issue of getting at truth and reality, and specifically in the area of the Apollo moon missions, what happened and what didn't happen. The module set down on the surface of the moon, the amount of propulsion that would have been required to do that, and it leaves no cloud of dust, no crater.
Having seen hundreds of rocket firings when I was employed by Rocketdyne, I know that the jet of the lunar module lander, the lunar lander, would have created an enormous crater. It would have scoured the moon's surface. It would have tossed up rocks, sand, everything, and created a crater maybe so large that the entire lunar lander could have sunk into it. After all, we're dealing with a 10,000-pound thrust engine, which is pointed directly at the surface, lowered into the surface, and yet, if you look at pictures of the lunar lander on the moon, there is no disturbance whatsoever under the lunar lander's rocket.
And no dust deposited in the pads, the cup-shaped pads at the bottom.
That's another good point. Dust would have been blown six ways from Sunday and would have landed everywhere.
And then the famous scene, which has been played over and over, where they are landing, they're setting down, and you're hearing the astronaut talking through it.
Oh, that's a good point. I became aware of that only recently, that here's Neil Armstrong talking about landing on the moon with a microphone, and yet he is sitting practically on top of a rocket engine that is putting out sound levels of about 140 or 150 decibels. Now, we know that is absolutely impossible. to overcome that sound level inside the lunar lander with a normal human voice.
Eagle, we got you now. It's looking good. Over. Roger, copy. Eagle, Houston, after yaw around, angles, S-band pitch, minus 9, yaw, plus 1-8. Roger, you're a go to continue power descent. You're a go to continue power descent.
Altitude now 21,000 feet, still looking very good. Velocity down now to 1,200 feet per second.
You're looking great to us, Eagle.
Give us a reading on the 1202 program alarm.
Roger, we got you. We're going at alarm.
Good radar data. We're now in the approach phase. Everything looking good. Altitude 4,200.
Houston, you're a go for landing. Over.
Roger, understand. Go for landing. 3,000 feet. Shot alarm.
Altitude 1,600. 1,400 feet. Still looking very good.
700 feet, 21 down. 33 degrees. 100 feet, down at 19. 1201.
1201. Roger, 1201 alarm. We're go. Same type. We're go.
Altitude, velocity, light. 3.5 down. 220 feet. 13 forward. 11 forward, coming down nicely. 200 feet. 4.5 down. 5.5 down.
60 seconds.
Lights on. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. Good. 40 feet down 2.5. Picking up some dust. 4 forward. 4 forward. Drifting to the right a little. Good. Okay. Contact light. Okay, engine stop.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Okay, we've changed our graphic picture here in the background, and it's a one-sheet poster that I put together from pictures on the website, www.geocities.com/Apollo Reality/. And the gentleman that put this together got actually these images off the Langley Research Center website, and some of these actually you're just seeing for the first time yourself, isn't that right, Bill?
That's right. Yeah, I'm amazed to find these pictures. I've never seen any of them before except the one in the upper right, and what amazes me is this one here showing a model of the moon with a camera track, showing how easily it would have been to fake the filming of the moon.
And then the image just to the right of that shows like the finished moon.
Exactly.
With somebody sitting at the controls, maybe turning it or...
Right. These are very revealing pictures, and I strongly recommend people with PCs to download them and study them. And of course, this brings up the subject of the death of whistleblowers. Men like Gus Grissom, who was burned to death along with Chafee and White.
He went pretty open with it, putting a lemon on
He was going to give an interview about what he really thought about Apollo. And as you say, he hung a lemon on the command capsule on the day that he was murdered. And we should also look at Scott Grissom, his son's evidence that a secret switch was installed in the capsule to ignite the fire that killed Grissom, Chafee, and White. We could go on for quite a while about the death and injury to people that have pursued this Apollo hoax subject very diligently.
They went to a NASA spokesman, who was Brian Welch.
Oh, yes,
and
right.
They asked him about some of these anomalies.
Right.
You recall what he had, what he said about some of the things
that
were asking?
Well, he tried to dispute everything that the Apollo hoax advocates brought out, but the interesting thing is that about a month after he gave this interview, he was dead.
That always kind of puzzled me, because he was at least trying to hold on to it, right? So
right.
Do you think they would have actually killed him just because he didn't do a good enough job? Or?
Yes, I think that's what happened. He didn't do a good enough job. So they killed him as an example to other people who are defending, like Richard Hoagland. Hoagland obviously is a fake, and he's an employee of NASA who on many occasions has tried to discredit me and my associates.
There are much better mysteries that call into question some of the photography, which I agree with you, looks frankly hoaxed.
Well, some of it could have been staged and they could have released it, Richard.
Exactly. That's what some of my photographic experts that I've called in over the years, you know, and I've been to Goddard, I've looked at the NSSD film. I mean, I have examples, actual examples, Eric, of NASA airbrushing the moon.
Well, I know this.
But you see, I have a different model.
So you're saying they faked some of the photos?
I think they faked some photos. I think they've hidden other things in the photos, and I'll give you my bottom line. I think there is an enormous Apollo conspiracy, but I think we've been sold the wrong conspiracy to keep people like you, bright guys who are asking good questions, looking in the wrong direction, which these people are past masters of doing, because the real conspiracy is not that we go to the moon. It's what did we find on the moon?
Oh, no, there's aliens
up
there.
They don't want us to know. And as I said earlier in the show, I found areas where NASA faked the imagery, I believe, to hide really cool stuff.
Okay.
And I found other areas where the photographs are consistent with us landing on the moon.
And it's possible, Richard, that some of these beauty shots were staged and they threw them in there and grouped them in with the real ones.
Exactly.
Next up, let's go to our wild card line. You're on the air with us. Hi there.
Our next speaker is Professor James McKinney.
If you double the size of your rocket, you don't double the size of your payload. So you're very limited. And now let's try and get to the next planet or out to the moon. We have to start sending individual things up there, couple them together, and then go out to these other planets. By the way, there's a small problem with going to the moon, and inch by inch, NASA is leaking out that they know that there's a problem there. It's called the Van Allen belts, high radiation belts of charged particles around Earth, and we don't know how to get through them, they say. Well, isn't that interesting? Because there sure didn't seem to be a problem back in 1969. Obviously, they didn't go to the moon. The United States did not go to the moon. The Russians knew it all along. I thought at the time we did, but I've since learned we absolutely did not. And there's no question about it. And they're starting to figure it out. NASA has a program called Living with a Star. That's a pretty name for how do we get through the Van Allen belts. They have all their top scientists working on it. It's a tremendous problem because we do not have any kind of a spacecraft that we can send up that doesn't have metal in it. And when these charged particles hit metal, they produce X-rays. Nothing you can do to get around that. So anybody sitting around something metal in outer space in the Van Allen belts is going to be French fried. And so that whole thing was a giant hoax. And you have second and third tier scientists in the United States who are running around saying, oh, yes, we did, yes, we did. But the very top level people, what I call the tier one scientists, the black op mill scientists, know for a fact we didn't go. And it's a real problem. They don't know how to get through there. This picture is with the new Hubble camera, and it shows that, in fact, if you take this angular distance out to Pluto and you translate it into the surface of the moon, we can, in fact, resolve the landing sites, the alleged lunar landing sites. And the way you would do this is you take the pictures at dusk when the shadows became very long, and it would be a very hard thing for them to fake. So at any rate, we have telescopes on Earth that are much larger than the Hubble. Much better resolving power. So why, you would think these astronomers would be chomping at the bit to show you those lunar landing sites and look at the incredible resolving power of this telescope we have here. Why have none of them done that? Because there ain't nothing there. And we get all kinds of excuses. Oh, we can't turn the telescope up there because the moon's too bright. Well, then all of a sudden we saw the full moon on a web page, on a NASA web page, the entire full moon taken with the Hubble Space Telescope. And you're telling me they can't take one little teeny patch of the moon, which is millions of times less bright. So bottom line is, they know, they didn't go.
Join us now on a quest for the truth to the moon. In this film, we shall not only prove beyond all reasonable doubt that many of the official NASA images of lunar exploration are fake, but we shall also examine the motives for the biggest lie put before the world. Why did NASA repeatedly fake lunar images and photographs? Why did NASA stage lunar expeditions which did not happen? The answer will surprise you. NASA spent gigantic sums of money during the 1960s, but most of it was spent on the ground, not in space. Huge American corporations, many of which were manufacturing hardware for the military, made gigantic profits designing space vehicles and, more importantly, life-sized models of spaceships and even huge stage sets resembling the lunar surface. Someone in NASA had realized that after taking billions of dollars from the American people, if they couldn't make it to the moon, they would fake it to the moon.
Obviously, if you're going to somewhere that nobody has been before, you need to have a simulator which recreates that environment as closely as you can. If you're going to the moon, you recreate the surface of the moon. And here we see a section of the lunar surface created. It's about 30 foot high, 30 foot long, 35 foot long. Scale is given by the two people standing in front of it. There were plenty of simulation exercises, but the point is, and this is, should be taken into account in virtually everything that is discussed with the Apollo program, 400,000 people may have worked on the program in total, but none of them had a need to know more than his own job required. The people who were making the rockets didn't know what the people who were making the spacesuits were doing, and because they had no need to know about that. Their job was to make the best models and the best simulation of the lunar surface that they could. And if we come up to this picture here, we see the three scales on which these models were built. We have here the whole moon as one unit. It stands about 20 foot high. We have here behind it a section of the surface of the moon. You'll notice it's curved. And here we have a more detailed section of the lunar surface.
What you're saying is that the images which we're told show a camera pointing out the window of the lunar module as it's coming into land on the moon could well have been filmed previously using these large-scale models.
That's right. It could well be that what we are looking at are films of realistic models. We have no means of knowing if they were actually taken on the lunar surface or whether what we're watching is part of the simulation exercise and the training exercise. And you'll notice here on these models there is a camera track. A camera starting at this end, coming down here, would approach the moon or appear to approach the moon and become ever closer towards it. This is a simulation rig that was built. This is the command and service module of the Apollo program. And you'll notice that the window here looks out onto a block here. And there's another one here. They're curved. These are the screens onto which the lunar surface was projected as the craft made a simulated approach towards the lunar surface.
Is what we're seeing a mixture of fact and fiction.
It is fact. It is fiction. It's mixed together. It's hard to separate them until you examine it closely. If a spacecraft is in deep space, the only possible explanation for a light seen through the window of the spacecraft is the sun. It's the only bright light in space. If it's not the sun, then it has to be some other artificial light, which implies that that particular image is possibly fiction.
July 1961. NASA was soon being criticized for the flimsy construction of their hardware. The first orbital capsules did not even have windows in them for the astronauts to look out of. One of the most vocal critics was one of NASA's most respected astronauts, an all-American hero named Virgil Gus Grissom, who almost drowned when recovery helicopters were unable to lift his space capsule from the sea. After a successful journey into space, Gus Grissom almost died through NASA's bad planning. Or was this an early attempt to silence Gus Grissom? May 1963. Astronaut Gordon Cooper experiences re-entry problems in his Faith 7 rocket ship. The prototype lunar module, known as the LIM, had serious stability problems. At this stage, there was no guarantee that even if NASA managed to get a spaceship orbiting the moon, they could land safely without killing the crew.
Which we see of the LIM approaching the moon be filmed in a TV studio?
It was filmed in a TV studio. There's absolutely no doubts whatsoever about that. And the way that this film was created was by the use of models. There's nothing secret about the models. They exist. You can go and see them today. The models were very lifelike, very realistic. There is one that is a life-size model. It's in Flagstaff in Arizona. It's 2 miles long, and it's an exact replica of the Sea of Tranquility. The photographs were used to create from those images the replica of the Sea of Tranquility, so that if it was flown over in a helicopter, it would appear as if it was a spacecraft approaching a similar area to land. So yes, all the scenes of the lunar surface were filmed on Earth.
Radiation, and without having spacesuits nor spacecraft which can protect the occupants from radiation, NASA convinced the American people to pay $40 billion for the space program.
The most lethal forms of radiation, of course, are at the higher end of the spectrum. That's gamma rays and X-rays. We know what ultraviolet can do. If you stay out too long in the sun, you get sunburn and skin cancer and die, and it's all very sad. But gamma rays, and X-rays especially, are particularly lethal to humans, unprotected humans. There was no protection that I have been able to identify. I found no reference to it. I found nothing that will tell me what level of protection is offered. So I have to assume none was. I've contacted the manufacturers of the spacesuits, and they said there was no radiation protection built into the spacesuits, because I asked them if these same spacesuits could be used by technicians to go into Chernobyl or Three Mile Island, because the nuclear reactors produce the same radiation as produced in space. They said no, not advisable, no protection.
James Van Allen grew up in the small Iowa town of Mount Pleasant during the 1920s. He was an exceptional student, became class valedictorian, and exhibited an intense vision that even then looked beyond our planet.
The environment was the time of the Cold War, and it was something scary. It was something for a child, it seemed very scary to have to hear about bomb shelters and hiding under our desks. And I remember first hearing that my father was going to go to Russia and being so frightened by that, and asking my father, why was he going to Russia? Wasn't he scared? And I remember him explaining to me that in the scientific community, what they do, and as they take data and exchange data, somehow that transcends what is going on in the political arena. So that there is always a sense that the quest for intellectual activity was something very, remember that, so that the Cold War suddenly didn't seem very cold to me, even as a young child.
The media focused on the Explorer 1 achievement as, at last, legitimizing the U.S. as a worthy adversary to confront the communist Sputniks. The public seemed captivated with the propaganda created by this new space race. Dr. Van Allen and his students, however, chose to focus on the data that was returning from their scientific instrument inside Explorer 1.
When the first results came back, the group at the University of Iowa, this was Van Allen and Ernie Ray, then began to help with it, eventually Carl McElwain, saw immediately that there was an anomaly, there was something unexpected.
We have encountered a very great increase in radiation intensity, which is vastly beyond what could be due to cosmic rays alone.
We call it geomagnetically trapped radiation. And I gave an explanation of what my interpretation at a press conference following the scientific session. And one of the reporters stood up, and he was trying to visualize what I was saying. And he said, "You mean it encircles the Earth like a belt?" I said, "Yes, that's great. That's what it is. It's like a belt around the Earth." And so that's the way they got the name of Radiation Belt from this exchange of this newspaper reporter and myself.
Well, certainly the discovery of the radiation belts was the most important discovery of the International Geophysical Year, because it represented a discovery of some major phenomenon that had a substantial impact both on scientific research and on plans for manned flight later on.
In late 1958 and early 1959, Van Allen flew instruments on Pioneers 3 and 4. Both were unsuccessful attempts to hit the moon, but their flights provided the Iowa group with essential confirming data. Pioneer 3 documented the existence of a second radiation belt, and Pioneer 4 became the first U.S. spacecraft to orbit the sun.
Any ill effects from the Van Allen radiation belts?
No, now I'm not sure we went far enough out to encounter the Van Allen radiation belt. Maybe we did.